All right, so let us move ahead now. There is something called shear modulus or the shear stress as well. And that is more important when it comes to breaking a solid or being very careful about the structure you're building. Write down shear modulus. So shear modulus is about the shear stress. So let's take a simple example of how shear stress looks like. Okay. They will draw a straight line. So here it is. This is the, let's say, box of a solid, and the lower surface is fixed. You're pushing the upper surface with a force F. When it comes to longitudinal, the force was perpendicular to the surface. Either it was compressing or stretching. Yeah. But when it comes to shear, the force is parallel to the surface.
Correct.
And the kind of deformation you will see is that the upper surface, since it is free to move, goes like this. Fine?
Yeah.
Yeah.
So the shear stress is basically force divided by area that is parallel to the force. This area.
Okay. Yeah.
And how do you think we should quantify deformation? This length is, let's say, L.
You could look at the angle.
Yeah.
Or should I say that how much is the displacement? Delta X. Should that be my deformation?
Yeah, correct.
But if I take a larger length of the solid, don't you think that delta X will be different? Delta X will be more and more.
Right. So then it will be.
So it has angle. To be angle.
Yeah.
Angle is a better representation. Let's say angle is theta. I'll not take alpha. Alpha we have been using for other. Theta remains same, doesn't matter what is the length. Okay, so epsilon is basically theta, which is roughly equal to tan of theta, because theta is very small. And tan of theta is basically delta L by L. Getting it?
Yeah.
Yeah.
Fine. So this is a ratio between shear stress and the shear strain is called modulus of rigidity. Please write down. And this is very important because it will take 3 times lesser effort to break a solid like this than stretching and compressing.
Okay.
So write down like this. This is. This will be FL by parallel area into delta X. Now, for the same material, for steel only, do you think the G and Y will be same or different?
Different.
Different, yeah.
So roughly, G is roughly Young's modulus divided by 3, roughly.
Okay.
For most material. Okay.
Okay.
And this is how the earthquake breaks the solid. It is 3 times easier to break a solid. In fact, scissor, when you use a scissor, so in scissor, what happens is there are 2 metallic plates. Right, there are 2 metallic plates that move on top of each other.
Right? Yeah.
Yeah.
So when you do that, basically you are applying force parallel to the surface. As in, can I say? So you see this scissor?
Yeah.
Okay. So you can see the upper plate. This plate is moving on that plate. Okay. Yeah. And suppose there is an object in between. All right. Then this edge will arrest the object's lower surface, and then this surface will apply a force parallel to the surface.
Okay.
And that solid breaks easily. When you are using scissor, you are basically applying the shear stress.
Okay, on the paper. Yeah.
And similarly, knives as well. Knife, what it does is that there is, let's say, an object like this. You have knife which is cutting it like that. So basically, you are applying a force parallel to this surface.
Yeah.
It is getting cut like this. You have always applied force in this direction.
Yeah, okay.
So that is also shear action. You don't apply force like this to break apart, let's say, potato.
Yeah.
That will be longitudinal. But we are using knife. It is much easier to apply shear to break a solid. And we have been doing it day-to-day tasks. All right, so let's take a question on the shear modulus as well. The value of G is given. 8.6 into 10 to the power 9. Done?
One sec, almost. Yeah, so we've got an answer.
What is the answer?
I'm getting 16.1 into 10 to the power of minus 4 meters.
You always miss one factor of 10. Always.
Oh.
Check.
Yeah.
Is it 16 into 10 power 5?
Yes.
Okay. Got it.
So check.
Yes, I'm checking. Also.
All right. So this is the shear modulus. I don't need to solve, right? You both have it?
No.
Okay.
No, precise.
All right. Now, there is a small experiment to determine the Young's modulus of a material of a wire. Okay, let's discuss that. So, I will quickly draw the experimental setup. I think this chapter will be over today. So, we don't need to drag it to the other day. So basically, what I'm doing is I'm having two similar wires. Okay. I'm having two similar wires, and both have this weighing plane. And both of them had same length initially. But this particular weighing pan, I'm adding weight because of which the length increased. Fine.
Yeah.
So what I'm doing is I'm also attaching a scale like this over here. And then I'm putting a pointer from the second wire. Okay. So earlier it might have been pointing over here, but as it got stretched, the pointer moves down. So this much will be the delta L.
Okay. Yeah.
Yeah.
But this is the delta L for the length this much. Okay, you need to be very careful. For this length, this is the delta L.
Yeah, okay.
Are you getting it? So if you want L for entire length, you should connect a pointer over here at the end.
Yeah.
Okay. But anyways, that precaution you can take.
This one is the one from the top to the bottom. That's delta L.
No, delta L is for this length.
Yeah, okay.
This length got changed by delta L.
Okay.
If you attach the bottom, delta L will be more then.
Yeah.
Okay. But ignoring this length, suppose I am attaching at the bottom only, I can say that the strain is delta L by L. So I have found delta L and L. I exactly know what is the load I am keeping here. So I know the sigma also, which is F by A, F is mg, whatever load I'm keeping there, okay? So Young's modulus will be equal to sigma by epsilon. Got it?
Yes.
All right, so let us move to the last bulk modulus. What do you think bulk modulus will be?
Oh, the
volume.
Compressing it from both.
Yeah. Compressing or, yeah.
Yeah, it is basically change in volume, okay? So it has to do with change in volume, and what changes the volume? Basically when you apply forces from all the sides. Okay, so this force usually is applied by a fluid, because fluid is something which can apply a uniform compression from all sides. All right, so the bulk modulus, the cause is pressure only. Pressure itself is force per unit area. Okay, so the cause is pressure. We say that sigma is pressure only. And what about epsilon? What do you think?
The same thing. I mean, it's delta V by V.
Volume, yeah.
Delta V by V. Change in volume by initial volume.
Yeah.
Getting it?
Yeah.
Okay. Now, in this case, since you're compressing, delta V will be less than zero. Okay. So the bulk modulus. By the way, sigma is not P, it is delta P. Atmospheric pressure is anyway there.
Yeah.
Oh, yeah. Okay.
Extra pressure you are putting, that is delta P. That is my sigma. Okay. So bulk modulus is basically ratio between these two quantities, delta P divided by delta V by V. There is something wrong in the expression. Can you tell me quickly what it is? Something I have missed.
Is it the sign or something?
Exactly. Bulk modulus should be positive number. You won't say that.
Yeah.
You won't say that it is my strength of a material is negative.
Yeah.
So you automatically put a minus sign. That is why you see a minus.
Oh.
So this can be written as minus V. If I write in a differential form, it will be minus V dP by dV.
Yeah.
And we know that if you go inside the fluid, pressure will be what? Atmospheric pressure plus rho gh. So change in pressure is how much? Rho gh only.
Rho gh, yeah.
So your delta P is basically rho gh in a fluid. And when you deal with bulk modulus, you automatically assume that you're dealing with a very small object. So the pressure, you will say that it is more or less same for the entire object. Otherwise, you'll argue that the pressure here is something and here it is something else because there is a height difference. Fine. I'm saying that assume the object is very small and height difference is negligible.
Okay,
whenever we are solving any problem related to bulk modulus, until and unless it is specified that it has a height of 2 meter, 5 meter, like that, we are going to assume that the object is negligible in
space. Yeah.
Okay. Let's take this question now. Both of you write down. The average depth of Indian Ocean. Do you know how much it is roughly?
No.
Average depth of Indian Ocean is around 3 kilometers.
Oh.
It's an average depth. So somewhere it could be around 5 kilometer also.
Yeah.
It is extremely deep. So 3 kilometers is the average depth. You need to find out the compression of the water itself at the bottom of the sea. Bottom of the ocean.
Oh.
The bulk modulus is given as 2.2 into 10 raised to the power 9. Newton per meter square. Take G as 10 meter per second square. Find out delta V by V.
Yeah.
How much?
I'm getting minus 1.4 into 10 to the power minus 5. Meter cube.
1.4.
Wait, no, not meter. Yeah. No, wait. Yeah, minus 1.4 into 10 to the power minus 5.
What? No.
I'm getting 73.33.
Is it?
Yeah, for some reason.
Well, what have you used the H? What you have written?
Oh, wait, I didn't convert it into meters. Wait.
Factor of 10, Dhruv is missing.
Yeah.
Don't miss that when you deal in money.
Oh, what mistake did I make then?
So you have
now I'm getting minus 1.4 into 10 to the power of minus 2.
Now it is correct. Negative you should remove. When they are saying find out compression, that find out compression. That is correct then. But if I say that what is the compression, fractional compression, then you should tell me a negative number. No, sorry. Then you should tell me a
positive.
Did you get Arushi the answer?
We're making a mistake.
So delta P is H rho G. H is 3000. Rho is 1000.
Yeah.
G is 10. This is delta P.
Yeah, got that.
Okay. So delta V by V is delta P divided by B. So
yes,
is 1.36 10 to the power minus 2.
Okay, fine.
Or in terms of percentage, 1.36%.
Yeah.
Okay. Now, since the volume is I'll just talk about that. Since the volume is decreasing, of course, density will increase.
Increase, yeah.
Right? So density is what? Mass by volume.
Correct.
This is my density. And I can write it as M divided by the volume will be V naught plus delta V. Okay. So this can be written as M divided by V naught 1 plus delta V by V naught to the power minus 1. Okay. And this can be written as M by V naught. This is binomial approximation, delta V by V naught. Rho. So rho is equal to initial density M by V naught, rho naught 1 minus whatever delta V by V naught. Okay. So like this, you can deal with change in density also. And since delta V is negative, rho will be more than rho naught.
Yeah.
Any doubts till now?
No.
Okay. So this chapter is practically over. Just that at the end, there are few application of elastic behavior of the material and will not get into too much of this. I'll tell you the few expressions. For example, if you have this rod like this, and if you hang a mass at the center, this thing will bend. This you can say is delta. If you put a mass over here, let's say it has mass which creates a weight W. So experimentally it is found out, let's say this is length L. Experimentally, the dip of the center point is found to be WL cube divided by 4B D cube Y. What is D? See, the length is the length dimension, then there is width and the height also.
Yeah.
Okay. So that is what it is. B is the breadth and D is the depth.
Okay.
Okay. So that is the reason why you have beams having I shape. Okay. when you use I-shaped beams, not able to draw the symmetrical one, but anyways, if I use I-shaped beam and put it horizontally, then this becomes my the value of D. Okay, so if I increase the value of D, my dip decreases.
Oh.
So that is the reason behind the I shape of the beam.
Okay.
So that is all it is in your syllabus. There are much more wider application of elastic behavior. The way you make the arch, it is usually curved like this. Why this kind of shape? Why not anything else? So there is a reason behind all of this, which you're going to learn in the engineering. Fine. So we have 15 minutes. We'll solve a couple of questions. Is there any doubts?
No.
Here is the question. There are two masses connected and there are two wires also. Young's modulus of this is Y1, length is L1, and area of cross section, let's say, is same. I'll not complicate it. So this is Y2, L2, area of cross section is A. This mass is M1 and that mass is M2. Okay?
Yeah.
You need to find the elongation on both the wires. The wire's mass is negligible.
You'd find the what on both wires?
You need to find the elongation on both. Are you stuck or doing it?
I'm doing it. Okay, yeah, so I got an answer.
One second.
How much?
So I got G into M1 plus M2 into L1 over A into Y1 plus.
First, tell me for this what you got.
For yeah, so the, for that, that's what I got. G into M1 plus M2 into L1 upon AY1.
Stress for this wire is how much?
Stress? Wait, I didn't do...
Without finding stress, how can you find strain?
I directly...
No, that is not correct. How much is stress? Answer me that.
That's a force per area, right? So M1 plus M2 into G by A.
See, you guys are not paying attention to the basics. Can't you draw a free body diagram and see what is the force acting on it? So let's say the here the force is T1. This will also be T1. This is M1. This will be M1G. This will be pulled up by T1. And this is going to be pulled down due to T2 as well. This is M1. And then this get pulled up by T2, this pulled down by T2, and then you have M2. This is M2G, and this is T2. Everything is at rest. So T2 is what?
M2G.
T2 is M2G. T2 minus M2G is 0, so T2 is equal to M2G. And in order to find T1, for this M1, I will draw the free body diagram and write the equation T1 minus T2 minus M1G is equal to 0. So T1 is T2 plus M1G, so it is M1 plus M2G. This T1, that is T2. So sigma 1 is T1 by A. So that is M1 plus M2G by A.
Yeah.
Sigma 2 is T2 by A. So that is M2G by A. Okay, now it is simple. So delta L1 by L1 is equal to Young's modulus times of that should be equal to the stress M1 plus M2 by A into G. So from here you can get delta L1 by Y1, and for the delta L2 you write like this. Okay, so if you don't follow these steps, you're not going to get marks in any school exam you're writing at least. Got it?
Yeah.
Yes.
Fine. So I'll send you the worksheet for this chapter. Okay. Finish it off once for all. It's a small chapter. You have to complete it, and then you don't have to revisit this chapter again and again. Thank you.
Sure.
And next class, we will start a new chapter, Kinetic Theory of Gases. Any doubts, anything on this chapter? Let me know.
No.
No doubts. Okay. So I'm going, let me send the worksheet. And after the call only, I'll send you on the group. Okay. So
yeah.
That's for today. We'll have soon another class. Okay. Bye.
Thank you, sir. Bye.
Thank you, sir. Bye. Thank you.